into the matrix, so I knew that they were doing the Christ.
May I make a local market?
You show that to Bruce Whitaker, don't you? That's too much. Did you send that, sell that, thank you, go to the museum for his, he wants that for his friend. I thought that Bruce Whitaker wanted it, don't you remember? Did he say that? No, he talked to you about it at your house, he wanted it.
Oh, no, no, make it.
Oh, yes, no, no, I wait, right. He changed his mind, he, oh, okay.
Good morning.
This next song is a new one that Alan has introduced to us, so hope you'll help us then.
You can blame me if it doesn't go well.
That's exactly. You'll keep us on track with the tune, I'm sure.
Tree of my heart, I know some mystery in your name. the dying to rise in glory, may we see ourselves in you. If we learn to live your story, we may die to rise anew. We may die to rise anew.
Come.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to those of you that are watching online this morning. We pray that your worship with us will be blessed and that you'll receive encouragement to live for Christ this week. Welcome to any guests who are here today. It's great to see you all. And I just want to thank the whole St. Philip community from the bottom of my heart for the welcome that you gave me and to me, to Denise as well, last week. What an incredible blessing. We sat on the grass after the service and just opened the cards and looked at the gifts and were just completely blown away by the generosity and just the passion you have for this community. It's pretty cool. I'm talking about the greater Oak Bay, Victoria area as well. And I'm sure the businesses that you went to will thank you as well. Well, today we gather in this place in the presence of the Creator, and we acknowledge that we worship on the traditional and unceded territories of the Lekwungen-speaking peoples. We pledge to continue the work of reconciliation with our Songhees, Esquimalt, and Wasanich First Nations sisters and brothers who have stewarded these lands from time immemorial. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. This moment open to the Spirit of God. I invite you to take your outlines for this morning. We're going to pray the collect prayer together. A collect is what it says. It draws together the themes of the day, and it's something that you can pray not only right now, but take with you and pray throughout the week. Maybe at breakfast time, maybe at some other time of the day. I find it very helpful to focus us on the theme of the week. So I'll say the first line and you say the rest with me. First line and you say the rest with me. God of all consolation, your Son comforted the grieving sisters, Marthy and Mary, for your breath alone brings life to dry bones and weary souls. Pour out your Spirit upon us, so that we may face despair and death, with the hope of the resurrection and faith in the one who called Lazarus forth from the grave. Amen. Please be seated as we invite the children, if there are children here, to come and extinguish the lights on the tenebrae wreath. I think there's a couple of others.
In Lent, we think about how sometimes we want more than we need. When we are greedy, we make it harder for the people to see the light of Jesus.
We have the extinguisher somewhere around, I guess.
Back here.
I'll get the other one.
Reading from the book of Ezekiel, chapter 37. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out of the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were many of them lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord. So I prophesied as I had been commanded, and as I had prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to its bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, prophesy to the breath, prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, thus says the Lord God, come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live. I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came out into them, and they lived, and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, our bones are dried up, our hope is lost, we are cut off completely. Therefore prophesy and say to them, thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves. O my people, I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves. O my people, I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live, and I will place you on your own soil. And you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gradual hymn is Breathe on Me, Breath of God. I invite you to stand as we sing it.
Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you.
Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. Mary was the one who anointed the Lord with perfume and wiped his feet with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus, "Lord, he whom you love is ill." But when Jesus heard it, he said, "This illness does not lead to death. Rather, it is for God's glory, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after having heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then, after this, he said to the disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble, because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble, because the light is not in them." After saying this, he told them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come to the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought that she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus again, greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench, because he has been dead 4 days." Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked up towards, upwards and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I knew that you always hear me. But I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet bound with strips of cloth, and his face wrapped in a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed him. This is the Gospel of Christ.
Please be seated. Thank you for your understanding when I just burst out and say something at the wrong time in the service. It's almost like, don't do what Dirksen is doing. But eventually, it'll be the other way around. So I promise to resist, but every now and then you'll manage to wrench from me. See how easily I've offloaded responsibility already? A golf story. So here's one. Did you know that the greatest golfer of them all, you probably all have your own ideas if you're golfers, but clearly, it's Jack Nicklaus. There's only one right answer to that question. Would take a break every winter, and then when spring had sprung, he'd go back to his childhood teacher, golf instructor, a man named Jack Grout, and ask him to go over everything from the beginning. And he meant it. Teach me, Jack, how to grip the club. How to aim, how to stand, how to start the swing again from the beginning. Now, any children left in here in the circle? Do you guys play, what sports do you play?
Soccer.
Soccer. Now, you know what a soccer ball is, right? Right? Every year when you start playing, you don't have to be shown that soccer ball again and be told, this is a soccer ball, do you? No. Right? So, this is crazy, you'd think, right? He might have won the greatest golf tournaments in the world, the Masters, the US Open, the Open Championship, and others, and yet he would do this year after year. It's kind of equivalent to Stephen Hawking reveling in the sheer beauty of the times tables every year before the Michaelmas term. Or Da Vinci, learning how to mix pigments as if he'd never done it before. Or maybe there's a master gardener or two here in the house. Maybe you're too shy to admit it. But you know, every year you go over what are the perennials and the annuals that work best in this microclimate. No, it's something you know. It's something you could recite in your sleep. So why would Nicklaus do this? It wasn't because he didn't know how to play. Then why? He had actually discovered a great secret. The difference between knowing something and continually discovering or learning it. Continually discovering it. And we see this same dynamic at work in our famous gospel text. And I know Lent in year A is a bit taxing to read these long gospel texts, so great job to the two readers the last couple of weeks. The raising of Lazarus is the sixth great sign in John's gospel, and the only one in which all the explaining takes place before the event. The actual raising of Lazarus is just a couple of verses at the end of the chapter. The prelude, however, all the rest, brims with longing, with pensive expectation and sorrow. But perhaps the greatest, most interesting feature of it is the way John describes Jesus' experience in and through it all, which is characterized not by an objective knowing, in the sense of having it all figured out, but in terms of a subjective, childlike learning, wonder, and allowing the emotions to come to him as the setting sees fit. Now, contrast this to so much popular religion, which is about learning the right things and getting it right. And of course, once you're right and convinced that you're right, you're proud of that. I got this thing figured out, got her sussed. What's there left to learn? To experience. Not a whole lot. Except to point out all the people who don't get it right, who don't know what you know. No wonder churchgoers are often bored to sleep, or bored of their faith, or wonder what the relevance of Christianity is. No wonder we look for the new outside of our faith. We've come to think of faith as a kind of moral control, a fixed body of knowledge, rather than growth in life and experience, which leads us further into the heart of God, further into the heart of the mystery of the world. But with Jesus, and you'll see this starting from chapter 2 onward in John's Gospel, the miracle of turning the water into wine at Cana, it's as if he's operating from scratch in each new situation, reacting and responding to what people are going through, what they're saying, as he listens to them and learns to see what God is up to in each situation. Here, in this text, we see him experience unfolding insight in real time. It's one of John's genius bits. He writes in very simple Greek that sounds simple when it's translated into English, but he's a beautiful existentialist. First, we see Jesus understanding that this illness will not lead to death, he says. It's not going to lead to death. This combines in that moment with an inner sense that he is to stay put, even though some of his best friends are imploring him to help in a desperate situation. Now, I can't even, I'm too much of a people pleaser to imagine the courageous inner no that he had to exercise in that moment. What a sense he must have had of not trying to please, but staying alert, attentive, and responsive. He showed incredible sense of self, strength of self in that moment. Then, this is followed by his comments on sleep, which slide into the clanging finality of Lazarus has died. Oh, so it does end in death. I mean, the Jews were pretty clear. Once you'd been dead for 3 days, you were dead. Like, you were dead. There's no, like, in-between phase there. You're dead. So Lazarus has died. He then starts to talk to his disciples about learning to believe, by which he doesn't mean capture a bunch of new information in this setting, but they don't understand. And, you know, maybe most of us don't get this. It's hard to get. They begin to walk towards Bethany in what I could only think of as a kind of cauldron of fear and confusion. I mean, they understand that there's people there that want to kill Jesus, and by extension, them. This is just a thing. They know it's happened, and they're not wrong. And then there's this cup half full pessimism. I can relate. I'm a good German. I come from good Germanic stock, right? It's Thomas. It's always Thomas in John's gospel. Come on then, let us go and die with him. I just picture Eeyore. There's only one, whenever Thomas speaks, that's the image. So there's this strong sense of foreboding and confusion. But now, the physical and emotional reality of Lazarus's death is about to land on Jesus in full force. Before this, it's all been kind of theorizing, words, playing with words. Confusing, yes, but still just words. And as Martha and Mary greet Jesus, they say the same thing to him. If you had been here, this wouldn't have happened. It's an accusation, but not really, for Jesus didn't cause Lazarus's death. It's really a front for their secret hope. And Martha kind of gives this away when she says, but you know, even now, we know that God will give you whatever you ask. What she's really saying, she doesn't really know. She's too shy to say it clearly. But really, they have this secret hope that somehow Jesus' superpower is life itself. And so even as they say what they say, kind of in this accusatory way, it's undergirded by a desperate longing. And then, just like a child, in that moment, Jesus feels. He just lets it come. He feels their pain, all their hopes on him. The enormity of the moment, which is really the human moment. You know the Christmas carol, right? The hopes and dreams of all the years are met in thee. And he weeps. God's tears for the whole sprawling, confusing, evolutionary beauty that is creation and humans trying to make sense of it. Martha has tried what religion, as a system, always tries. She tries this rational, doctrinal approach. You are the Christ, the Son of God, the one who has come into the world. Perfect response, perfectly right. She knows she's missing something. Jesus says in response to that, I am the resurrection and the life. Belief in a future promise is fine, necessary, and part of God's good news. Martha has said that she knows that Lazarus will be raised in the resurrection. But it also allows us to offload paying attention to the learning and discovery of the present moment. But if Jesus' superpower is life itself, then this future resurrection promise comes crashing into our here and now. Then Christ is someone for every time, for every moment, and every place. And the implied call within that is to stay present, to stay childlike, to learn to believe all over again. If last week's sermon could have been titled The Second Sight, this week's can be called The Second Naivete. We think we need the new or the different to quell our boredom. And so we plan holidays to exotic locales we've never been. Right, Joan and Larry? Been there. Love it. Fine. Beautiful to do. I can bug my warden. He bugs me. It's what friends do. But when it comes to the most important things in life, our faith being the number one thing, we don't need new things. We need old things. The most important things experienced with fresh wonder. We need, as Nicholas would say, to start from the beginning, or as Jesus would say, learn to believe. This is what we need at each stage. Sure, we know, but will we keep wondering? So here we are in an old place that is new. We have an opportunity over the next years, months and years, to listen to each other as if for the first time. And for me, it will be the first time, I guess, to bring our most cherished beliefs into conversation with the one who is both the resurrection and the life. What if we paid attention with an inner courage that allowed our childlike wonder to be more important than the need to please? What if we allowed our learning to be less certain, but always growing? I wonder if some of our grave clothes might drop off too. I invite you to stand with me as we affirm our faith. Together, we believe in God the Creator, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please stand, sit, or kneel as is suitable for you for the prayers of the people.
God of compassion, you have raised the dead and have made whole that which was broken. Just as your Son called Lazarus forth from the grave, you have offered us a transformed life in Christ through the power of the Spirit. We pray for grace to accept this gift. Root us deeply in your love so that we might serve you in the world. Let us pray with confidence, saying, Lord, in your mercy, and responding, hear our prayer. We pray for the church, that your kingdom on earth will be extended through the love and compassion of your people. We pray for our rector, Father Alan Dirksen, that you will affirm him in his ministry and give him wisdom and discernment as he leads us into the future. We pray for our Bishop, Anna Greenwood Lee, and for the people of St. Barnabas and their incumbent, Travis O'Brien. In our ecclesiastical province, we pray for the clergy and people of the Diocese of Yukon and Bishop Leslie Wheeler Dane. In the Anglican Church of Canada cycle of prayer, we pray for the theological colleges and training programs and ask that students will be encouraged in their call to ministry. In the Anglican Council of Indigenous Peoples cycle of prayer, we pray for victims of abuse that they may find healing for themselves and for their families. As we seek truth and reconciliation with our Indigenous brothers and sisters, create within us a spirit of openness and humility, and lead us into new paths of understanding and connection. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We uphold to you the congregation of Mar Elias Maronite Church in Syria and their priest, Father Basamni. We ask that you would meet their spiritual and material needs. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world. We are conscious of the suffering, despair, and hopelessness experienced by millions because of failed states, institutions, and economic systems. Through your Spirit, speak into the hearts and minds of individuals who have the power to deliver peace and justice, and the resources to provide shelter and daily bread. For the people of Haiti, we ask that you keep them safe from gang violence as the normalcy of daily life has been stolen from them. Give the children, families, and staff of Hope Home peace and assurance that you walk beside them as they live, work, and play in a climate of fear and violence. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We uphold to you the victims of the tornadoes in Mississippi and Alabama. Comfort those who have lost loved ones, and strengthen those who are embarking on the task of cleanup and rebuilding. Creator God, we are saddened that the goodness of your creation has been spoiled by our hands. We give thanks for the talented and committed people who are working towards remedies. Inspire each of us to do our part in the effort to restore your creation to wholeness. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our country, our province, and our communities. Give the leaders of our country the strength to govern with integrity and truth, so that political, economic, and ecological decisions might be honoring to you and in the service of all citizens. In our community, we offer up to you the issues and situations that seem beyond our capacity to solve. Give hope and comfort to those who are living on our streets with addictions and mental health challenges, and who may lack love and support of families and friends. Communicate that they are your loved and valued children. Open our eyes to the practical and material ways in which we can share from our abundance. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of love and compassion, send your gentle and healing touch to those in our community who are facing illness, and strengthen and comfort their families. Bruce and Kathy Fife and their daughter Heather, Robert Holloway, Helen Skuotis, and Molly Wontong, others who are remembered in the quietness of our hearts. Oh God, we thank you that you hear and answer our prayers. Guide and strengthen us this week that we might be a channel for new and abundant life through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites them to his table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we must repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your ways.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Having heard the divine promise to each one of us of forgiveness, healing, and reconciliation, we proclaim together,
peace.
The peace of the Lord is with us all. Let's exchange this peace. As we prepare to receive the sacred meal, we sing our offertory hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Giver of life, your Son has destroyed the power of death for all those who believe in him. Accept all we offer you this day and strengthen us in faith and hope through Jesus Christ, the Lord of all the living. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who was tempted in every way, yet did not sin. By his grace, we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, with angels and archangels and all who have served you in every age, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. And love you have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new, and bring us to that city of light, where you dwell with all your sons and daughters through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Father Almighty, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior taught us, let us pray.
Our Father in heaven,
bread, I want you to know that everyone is welcome at this table. Last week I made a couple of errors. I assumed that the folding of the hands was for a blessing. I know now that it's for the gluten-free. Am I right? No. So I've still got it wrong. So what is the sign for the gluten-free? You just tell me. That's the way it's going to be. With that, we break this bread. Let your church be the wheat which bears its fruit in dying.
If we die with him, we shall live with him. If we hold firm, we shall remain with him.
Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's go to the Kyrie. I don't know if I'm going to the Kyrie anymore. Please stand.
In this Eucharist, we have tasted the promise of your heavenly banquet and the richness of eternal life. May we who bear witness to the death of your Son also proclaim the glory of his resurrection. For he is Lord forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Glory to God, whose power working in us
and
we ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the Church and in Christ Jesus.
In Christ Jesus forever and ever. Amen.
You keep adding words to things. It's all good. Okay, I will get this right. We've got birthdays in the house. Come on up.
I want to announce that it's Ron Holloway's 80th birthday this week. He's not present with us, but Ron is watching on live, which is great.
Happy birthday, Ron.
It's also my 80th birthday later this week, together with my twin brother, Tony, who is in California, who I know will be either watching it live or later. So three of us are celebrating our 80th and very grateful for it.
So do you mind if we say a prayer, and you're standing in for all three. So you get triple blessing, but then you have to distribute it.
Yes.
Lord, thank you for my brother, Mike, and for the life you have given him. Think of the 70, but or 80. Lord, you've truly blessed him. Lord, we ask that this blessing would go to Ron, and Tony as well, and that that the blessing would continue for these three wonderful men, that your healing would come to Ron, and Lord, that you would just continue to use them in their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Yes, right. So you don't get all three things. Well, you can. They seem to be the one that most people go for. Okay, there you go. There you go. Okay, now I think we've come to the benediction. So please allow me to give you a blessing. Well, there's announcements first. Of course there is. So Larry is going to go ahead and give announcements. And anybody else? Beth, too.
Good morning. I am surprised it's Easter again. Life seems to go faster the older you get. So this morning we'll be collecting loonies and toonies to buy the flowers to decorate the church on Easter. Thank you.
Thank you, Beth.
Today is the last day of an art show where Gillian Rhodes and Victor Loyo and I are exhibiting our artwork. It's at the Glen Lyons School on Beach Drive. It closes at 3. It is a show. The great thing is it's 150 original works. And as of this morning, we had sold 61, so it's a really big sale, too, and a great celebration. So come and see the works of your congregation. Thank you.
I have two announcements. Announcement number one, which is in three parts. Part one. We are having a agape meal on Maundy Thursday, which is April 6th. So all are welcome. We are making it welcomes by having two sittings. The first sitting will be at 5 o'clock. Then the second sitting will be at 7 o'clock. The first sitting will have a cleanup, and then the second sitting will benefit from that cleanup. The second sitting will not clean up right away. They will leave everything in a unholy mess downstairs, and they will make their way right upstairs for the brief liturgy of stripping the altar for Good Friday. So that's part one. Part two is we need you to sign up. So at the back of the church, there are sheets that will indicate whether you want to come and will tell us which service you want to be at. Now, you know, if you sign up for the 5 and you change your mind and want to come to the 7, I have told Alan that would be okay.
Of course it will.
He was resistant at first. just kidding. And if you sign up for the 7 and you want to come to the 5, that's okay too. We will be prepared for all those eventualities. We just know that we can't put as many as might come in one sitting, so we're having two sittings to accommodate that. And the third part of that announcement is if you are willing to volunteer in some aspect of this, we will need people to set up. We will need people to take down the tables and everything. And we will need people
to make soup.
Yes, I got it. We need people to make soup. Now, we're going to have a common recipe for lentil soup. I don't have that common recipe. I am not that powerful. But it will be provided if you sign up for that. And the idea is if we need to mix soups together. We won't be mixing too many different types of soup. So please, at the back, sign up. If you have any questions, Sharon is the woman to ask. And okay, so that's the first announcement. The second announcement.
Is this coming in six parts?
No. This is only one part. I'm trying to make my announcements to match the sermon time. The second announcement is, bless her heart, Kathy Fife, who has been faithfully for many weeks in a row until she created a volunteer crew, sat at that computer and managed the overhead projection slides. Bless you, Kathy, for that faithfulness. Kathy has decided to retire from that task, and so we are looking for somebody to replace Kathy on the overheads. Now, I am looking for a volunteer, but if I don't get a volunteer, then I will be tapping people on a shoulder. You don't need more than three or four neurons functioning to do this task. It is not rocket surgery, okay? See me afterwards if you want to volunteer. I will provide training, or one of the other projectionists will provide the training necessary for this. And you know what? This is a very forgiving church. If you make mistakes, and I make them every time I do this, we all forgive you, okay? So I will leave it at that and turn it back over to the person you really want to listen to.
Thank you, Larry. I just can't resist. Even if you've attempted surgery on a rocket, you can do this job. All right. Love you, brother. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do God's will, working in you that which is pleasing in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever.
Amen. Please stand.
Thank you. go forth bringing Christ's healing presence into the world.
Thanks be to God.